Thank you for joining us. And I, along with our esteemed panelists and the Metro crew, am really glad to be able to speak to you guys today. We were caught by surprise. The coronavirus hit our country hard, and many industries have been gravely affected. Among them, the food and beverage and hospitality industries. As a result, this pandemic has created alarming challenges for everyone, and to be honest, we're unprepared for them. I set up this online panel discussion to hopefully dissect the situation and figure out ways to equip everyone for the next phase. We might actually end up having more questions than answers, but at least we'll come out of this more informed when making future decisions. So I've invited six good friends and experts in their respective fields to share their wisdom, experiences, and insights with regard to the spot we find ourselves in. First, we have the President and Chief Operating Officer of Foodee Global Concepts, which houses a varied roster of restaurants, from fine dining and homegrown concepts to Michelin-starred franchises and a food hall. Let's welcome Mr. Eric B.
Can't wait to share some of our insights that we discussed earlier on with everyone.
Next in line, Asia's best female chef for 2016 was built a food empire in Manila spanning three decades. Her industry imprint includes Cibo, Grace Park, Luso, and Cibo de M Signature Caterer. Ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Margarita Forés.
Hello, everyone!
Influenced by a very business-oriented family, he has been involved with various food programs, the recent one being Bang on Benguet. He holds a number of restaurants as well, and apart from that, he is the overall chairman of Franchise Asia Philippines for 2020. Thank you for joining us, Mr. Dominic Hernandez.
Hello, good morning, everyone.
From the hospitality industry, our next panelist is an experienced lecturer and administrator with a history of working in the higher education industry. She is the Assistant Dean for the College of Hospitality Management at Enderun Colleges and is skilled not just in food and beverage, but also event planning and advertising. Welcome, Ms. Bel Castro.
Hi. Just to manage expectations, my crystal ball is broken. So, but we're here to ask questions and hopefully find answers together.
Our next panelist is the hardworking Secretary of the Department of Tourism in the Philippines. Her work program includes creating a culture of sustainable tourism, increasing investments in the tourism sector, and enhancing programs on the tourism infrastructure, all of which she's been doing really good at. Ladies and gentlemen, Secretary Berna Romulo-Puyat.
It's nice to see everybody in the food industry, and I'm excited for today's talk.
Completing our guest lineup is Ms. Cecile, a prospectivist and trend forecaster based in Paris, with over 30 years of experience and with clients worldwide, dealing with a range of industries from cosmetic to cars and hospitality. She couldn't join us this morning, so we just recorded an interview I did with her yesterday. We really are in a dire situation. The problem is rooted in health and biology, but the long-term consequences will be gravely felt in economics. I would just like to kick things off by giving everyone an idea on where the world currently stands. For that, I asked Cecile's help. So here's her report. Thank you not only for accepting my invitation to be a part of this discussion, but also for waking up early for this interview.
Oh, it's okay. It's a pleasure.
How are you? How have you been?
Yeah, we're fine. We tried to get used to that weird situation of lockdown and it's more than a month now. And at the moment, it's supposed to be until May 11th, but maybe it could be longer. We don't know yet exactly. So you only have the food stores, grocery stores that are open, and pharmacy. So it means that all the restaurants, all the cafe, all the bar, all the museum, all the gardens, the parks, and all the other shops like bookstores, shops for garments, everything is closed. We don't know yet exactly what is going to happen. So they go on with delivery. But you have also a bunch of restaurants that were not used to do delivery that are changing their business model and trying to be more doing delivery or take off. So it means that they need to reinvent the kind of cooking they were doing so that you can put it in boxes And also some of the restaurants are trying also to manage their own delivery system, because as you know, the amount of money that all those aggregators are taking on delivery is it's quite a lot of money, so it means that it's eating all the margin of the restaurants. That's about the landscape, but it's difficult because many restaurants are now trying to find solution, because the longest the close down is going to last, the more their business is going to be changed, you know, at the end.
According to the World Travel and Tourism Council, an industry group based in London, layoffs in the sector are mounting at a stunning rate of 1 million jobs a day, with as many as 75 million jobs at immediate risk, and that the industry could lose as much as $2.1 trillion in business by the end of the year. Those are pretty big numbers and scary, right? Back in the Philippines, I'd like to ask our secretary, what's our situation tourism-wise?
Just to put things into perspective, tourism contributes about 12.7% of the gross domestic product. Last year, we actually reached 8.2 million tourist arrivals compared to the previous year of 7.1. So we were on schedule. We employ 13% of total employment, which was about 5.4 million. Last January, we actually had an increase of tourist arrivals about 8.8%. Last Feb, there was already a decrease of 45%. And last March, a decrease of 70% of tourist arrivals. And of course, April, it's zero. So that's where we are now. When you look at hotels now, you don't look at them as hotels for tourists. You look at them as hotels for accommodation for the essentials. We house the BPOs, our OFWs, bank employees, of course, our healthcare workers.
How are hotels managing the pandemic? I suppose you put up government restrictions in operating?
Well, initially, hotels weren't supposed to be open. But then when we said that we needed to open it to house all our frontliners. But then it was only with the condition that it was just only for accommodation. No room service, no kitchen. It's just for a place for people to stay. So at the moment, we are housing in the NCR alone, we have 30,503 rooms that are being housed. We're housing 12,848 BPOs, 10,139 OFWs. In the medical sector, about 500. Banking, 307. Telecom, 183. Basically, that's it. And we're expecting more OFWs to come in, about 150,000. So we're going to house them not only in the NCR, but also around the country.
To Bell, being in the hospitality industry, do you have anything to add to the situation of our of the hotels?
Well, we have the luxury of having our students in a classroom, right? And all we do is just tumble these things over and do a lot of thinking. I think everybody likes to talk about that there's going to be a new normal, right? But what does that mean, new normal? It will mean that we will have new processes and procedures. We have to find a way. There's a lot of movement that we had before that we have to find a way to move, to change the way it moves. Movement of cash, movement of people, movement of product. So in the school system, we're incubating a lot of these ideas. And there's always a silver lining. I think that we're going to, when we come out of this, we're going to be graduating, I think, the strongest batch of hospitality students you've ever seen. Because we've been through this battle. So front office, will the front desk finally vanish? Are we going to have contactless check-ins? How much of the stuff we are doing is going to go digital? How much will our, if there was any resistance now with cashless paying, I mean, I'm a dinosaur. I mean, I finally opened my GCash and I love it. It's not a question anymore of when we will open, because it will open eventually. I think now we have to focus on how do we open. And from what I've been reading in the US and in Europe also, I think to sit down and do absolutely nothing during this period is fatal. I think you should use this time, and I think you're talking about this earlier with Eric, this is a good time now to practice and to stress test your systems for this new normal. And instead of waiting for the new normal, I think flip it on its head. We have to define and create what will be our new norms.
With regard to the restaurants, the chefs are being forced to innovate during the pandemic.
We had to fine-tune our ways of packaging the food for delivery and for takeaway.
With regard to the restaurants, the chefs are being forced to innovate during the pandemic. For example, fast food chains are now selling their frozen goods. Noma, for example, started selling dining coupons, like a pay now, eat later type of thing. In Singapore, my chef friends started offering set meals to be delivered and enjoyed at home. And then some have simplified their menus to offer more familiar comfort food, like Alinea in Chicago is now offering beef wellingtons, which is a big jump from the usual sugar balloons, right? You are really forced to adjust to salvage the restaurants. So I'd like to throw a question to the restaurateurs. How are you guys coping right now?
I guess the brand that I have that is has the widest reach is Cibo. From 16 stores operating, we're down to, initially just 3 hubs, and as of today, 5. It's still like super minuscule to the sales that we were doing before, but we've had to convert all our sales, of course, into delivery and takeaway. And as everyone knows, Italian food doesn't travel well. You should eat it immediately after it's prepared. So we've had to fine-tune our ways of packaging the food for delivery and for takeaway. At the same time, we're also trying to get our staff to come in, because I think the biggest challenge initially with the lockdown was really getting your staff to travel because there's no transportation. And at the same time, initially the immediate sort of knee-jerk reaction was to go to third-party delivery services to get our food out. But now we realize that our front of house that was left with nothing to do, and we still needed to take care of them with their payroll and everything. So all of them have stepped up and have now been willing to do the delivery for us. So for Cibo, that's the picture. I think the one that will probably experience a lot more challenges is my catering part of the business, Cibo Di Marti, because then catering is all about getting together and people celebrating events at one table, and that's going to be a real challenge. I guess for all of us, the only way we can generate sales and still keep the business thriving is to just do delivery and take wherever we want.
How about you, Eric? How's your brand?
Well, it was tough. Tough decision to make. I mean, we're experiencing unprecedented things, so we had to react with unprecedented measures as well. So during the lockdown, we closed down 200 doors. So that's a mix of fast food stores, casual dining restaurants. But recently, we've opened 2 stores to test out our new SOPs, new procedures. Opening a store is actually easy, right? I think the new SOPs and the new protocols that are involved in opening a new opening a restaurant is the difficult part. So if it was a simple procedure of getting food from A to B, now you're gonna have more steps in between A to B that is actually more than the step itself, right? So we're having to sanitize the food, we're having to identify all the touch points, and it's a total reinvention of what we've been doing, because we're used to entertaining, you know. F&B is about service, it's about that communication between the restaurant and the consumer. I miss being in a restaurant, I miss that service, I miss sitting down, I miss being entertained. So it's a really different business altogether. It's a paradigm shift now from a 90%, 10% delivery. It's now going to be 90% delivery and maybe, luckily, 10% dine-in.
the fast food restaurants now, of course, we have a problem of, you know, saturating certain, because we depend on volume, the transaction count, and definitely we don't have that volume now, and our margins are very, very thin. We have to, post-COVID, we will have to rationalize in the fast food industry certain number of stores we're in, because right now you see two fast food branches across each other, sometimes even three, sometimes even four. But post-COVID, we don't see it as a sustainable model, because again, we're going to depend on the delivery business. So if you're in one retail trade area, you can't be four or five there competing after the same number of population that needs your products. So that's the thing with fast food now. Wearing the franchise industry hat today, we know that most of the food brands are in the franchising business model. So what we do in Philippine Franchise Association, one of the core themes and the core principles of PFA is actually responsible franchising, because it's a very powerful tool to expand your business, to scale, but it's also a powerful tool to abuse. So now is the best time to actually review all of the people who under the F&B franchising segment, not only F&B, even we franchise hotels, there's retail in the franchising model, there's health, there's schools. So we canceled the our yearly event, which is the Franchise Asia Philippines. We were supposed to have 60,000 attendees, 700 booths, and we were supposed to generate about 6 to 7 billion worth of business in that single event. Based on data, food delivery from 2020 to 2024 is supposed to have a compounded annual growth rate of 17%. And by 2024, food delivery, this is combined platform to consumer and resto to consumer combined, by 2024 is about 21 billion pesos. But with COVID, the 17% compounded annual growth rate of food delivery, I think it will double in a very conservative manner. It might even triple. So that's what we need to prepare for.
How are your employees getting by? What are your plans for them?
We're getting volunteers from people, paid volunteers, by the way. We also give a hazard pay, and we give an extra allowance for them during this time.
In the US, restaurants from big groups have been closing down. Like, the lifespan of a restaurant is usually what? 5 years, 10 years, 20 years even. But it's hard to accept the idea of closing all your restaurants in 1 week, which is, I think, what happened with Tom Colicchio. Before they even go into bankruptcy, they shut it down and lay off their workers, which is sadly one of the most unfortunate consequences to come out of this pandemic. How are your employees getting by? What are your plans for them?
Of course, we want to give them jobs. There's going to be donor fatigue. So we have to stimulate the economy. We have to, you know, have to consider that these people, they can't keep on expecting donations, you know, expecting free food, because there's going to be a stagnation in our economy, and that really won't help us in the long term. So as Gaita mentioned earlier, they're now utilizing all of their people, their own people, to deliver, to cook, multitask, all of these things. So because, you know, work gives us dignity also. It's different when you earn something rather than you just accepted it as donation.
Eric?
Well, on our end, we have about close to 4,000 employees. So we definitely had to prioritize that. So I think even before the government mentioned about giving out the 5,000 and having the companies do their 13-month pay, we've already tasked ourselves to do that beforehand, even though we could claim it or not. So because that was important, we didn't know how long this lockdown would have lasted. I mean, we thought it was going to be 2 weeks. Now we're into almost 4 weeks already. So we didn't know. But the main priority was making sure that our staff was safe. Also, the business cannot handle paying salary while there's no income coming in. So we had to tell them that, you know, we have to do this. But once we're back in action, we have to let them back. But we're seeing also that it's not that easy. We recently opened Hawker Chan and Tim Ho Wan. We're opening Mesa soon. We're getting volunteers from people, paid volunteers, by the way. We also give a hazard pay and we give an extra allowance for them during this time. But it's also very hard because people are afraid, right? They're afraid to go out, but they're also wanting to make income, right? So it's something that they have to weigh. Takot ba ako or pero wala naman akong pera. So should I go out and do this? So we're finding people. We're not forcing them to work. We're finding volunteers for paid work. And we always tell them safety is the priority. So I guess it was easier for us to implement all these new rules because it directly affected them.
With regard to your employees, did you find a lot of them volunteering or a lot of them more would want to stay at home?
Well, you'll really see the passion in the people that you had. If you were questioning if they had passion or not, now is the time that you would see really the people that step up during these times.
You know, during a challenging time like this, we always find like new awakenings. And I think what I've come to realize with the whole lockdown situation is that in the end, we're in business not primarily just for the bottom line. Essentially, it made me realize during the lockdown that this whole effort that we're doing to keep businesses alive is really mostly for our staff. And I think with the lockdown, what happened was many of them who wanted to come in couldn't come in because of the physical inability to do that. Many of the places where they're from, many of my staff are from Payatas or from San Mateo or from Montalban, where they're on total lockdown because they are undergoing like a lot of the COVID cases in that area. So the real challenge was to get them to come in. And many of them did want to come, and we wish that more of them would have been able to come in, but it was physically impossible. But in the end, whatever little effort we're doing now to open stores and to generate whatever income we can is really mostly to be able to keep our financial logistics in place. And I think that we're all becoming creative financially also to be able to sustain whatever we need to sustain, depending on the kind of business model we have at the moment.
These are the things happening at this very moment, and as to how long, we can't really tell just yet. But moving forward, I wanted to know, like, what can we expect so that we can prepare for it? So I asked Cecile, who's a trend spotter, where we are headed and what she sees in the future of the industry. So here's her reply.
So I would say that globally, every sector in every business is going to be affected and will need to change. For restaurants, I think one thing that we will have is that tourism in the coming months will go down. That's for sure, because many people are not ready to be again in a plane with other people, you know, for 8-10 hours, you know, blocked like that. So it means that many restaurants that were really working with tourism are going to suffer more, even because it means that maybe the local population does not have the money to pay that amount of money, which is expensive. But on the other hand, it means also that many French people, for instance, are not going to go on holiday outside, so they will stay inside, so they might bring money, you know. So it's also, so I think globally for the future, we will be more and more depending on local community, neighborhood, local community. And this is very important, so because we see that the restaurants that are working well are the ones that are really trying to do something also for the neighborhood, you know. This is important. But I need for many, I guess that for many people in restaurant business globally, not only in France, but everywhere, they really need to reinvent somehow their business model, to be more flexible, mm-hmm. To adapt to that new stand, the new standards, the new normal that is coming to be the one after the COVID.
So we're moving on to the future. According to the International Air Transport Association, the global airline industry will lose $314 billion US dollars in revenue this year. That's a 55% decline compared to last year. But even if restrictions are lifted, passengers will think twice flying again. Mm. And it's the same case with the restaurant industry. We have no clue as to when the customers will be comfortable eating out again. No one would want to spend a lot of time in places where there's hundreds of people. For Secretary Berna, pre-pandemic times, parang tagal na, it seems like a long time ago, tourism, as you mentioned earlier, had been on the rise, both internationally and locally. And then the virus hit. How hard would it be to bounce back and win the trust of the travelers, both here and abroad?
Well, now it's different. Whenever you look for a place to travel in, you always look at the food, etc. But now, all the travel decisions now will be based on perceptions and concerns over personal safety, standards, and hygiene. So when they look at a hotel, they have to make sure, or a place, that they're safe. For example, if you even want to travel, it has to be now, you can't be jam-packed. It has to be, the middle seat has to be empty. Because there has, you have to be 1 meter apart. In other countries, it has to be 6 feet apart. And when you talk about COVID, there's no such thing as large gatherings. So that's the same thing as what Gaita was saying, that that will take a hit at the moment. So right now, we have online training. Our online training is concerns about what we were saying about personal safety, standards, hygiene, and the tourist has to feel safe. But the good thing now is all our training seminars are obviously online, and we now have participants from Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. Before, we were we could only have like 50 to 100 in one place based on the room capacity. Now we have more than 1,000 per seminar. Even now, we're forced now to speed up our online accreditation for hotels. Because actually, under the law, you can't run your hotel without the DOT accreditation. And now the online accreditation includes sanitation, personal safety, and the standards.
Because of the stigma of the pandemic, do you think people might not help with the local tourism because people don't want to travel more?
Yeah, people have been talking about domestic tourism. Now they want to do it all by land. So we have to make sure that we have to talk to the LGUs to make sure how are they going to limit the people, how are they going to practice social distancing.
We talked about this last night. Spain is set to close its borders until Christmas, yeah. Then Italy until March next year. Do you think we will follow suit?
We're lucky enough that we had a lockdown or enhanced quarantine earlier on, because the other countries were waiting. It's more of it as like a wait and see for everybody. And what we did, what we were seeing in other countries, that the numbers were increasing per day. We had this enhanced quarantine earlier on. The enhanced quarantine is more for our hospitals to become ready, to have more beds, etc. So we were lucky in that sense that we were able to catch it earlier on. So, and as the other panelists were saying, now people are taking it seriously. People are taking safety seriously. It's not a joke anymore. We know that if we don't follow, then it affects everybody.
There's definitely a bunch of issues that we need to resolve after this, because things just won't be the same. We have to adjust to the new normal because the market would want to feel safe and comfortable in entering a public space. To give you guys an idea, Jean-Georges reopened his shops in China at the end of March, and he had government restrictions to follow, like taking the temperature of all the chefs and the customers, no tables bigger than 4, then there should be spacing of 6 to 8 feet between tables. Nobody touches money, so people need to go to an app on their phones to pay the restaurant. And then waiters are only there to bring wine, water, and food, nothing else. But the weirdest of them all is that the restaurant is so quiet. The customers and the chefs are not speaking to each other. But according to him, it's still working. And so far, business in China is back up at 40 to 50%. So I'd like for us to dissect the situation here in Manila. For example, for Eric D., your fine dining restaurant, how do you think the market will react to a setup where meals require an hour or so to finish?
It's very difficult for a fine dining setup. I mean, we go to a fine dining restaurant because we like the service, we like the attention to detail, we like sitting down and like white linens. So it's not just really about the food. I think restaurants in general is really a totality of service, ambiance, and food. So when you take out the rest of the components and just focus on food, it would be a little bit more difficult to balance out everything. Well, we've seen a lot of the fine dining sending home kits that they cook on their own, and then I've seen people kind of like, you know, going on WhatsApp calls of the chef one-on-one with their diners to kind of explain the food. I think at the current state, I think it's more firefighting. It's more on the fine dining restaurants trying to bring in streams of revenue to be able to, you know, pay for the staff. But I think it's not a long-term type of thing. I think people will still want to have that entertainment value, that service. So it will take time.
The reason why I started this conversation is because I didn't know how the restaurants will survive without talking to each other. I know we have chef societies, but I wonder if we have like restaurant associations that can perhaps help define these new standards or protocols or come up with ideas for everyone to work on. We need someone someone or a group of people who can set guidelines with regard to, for example, raising tables. I doubt we can do that now. Or boodle fight. Or Belle mentioned to me, what about serving complimentary peanuts and potato chips at the bar? That will all change. And so the reason why I came up with this is that we can discuss it, converse about it, and then later on, come up with a plan.
If your business contributed 90%, and coming from a dine-in population, now you're going to have to probably switch that around. So it's a totally different business model altogether. It's now a story about menu optimization and delivery optimization. Because for at least 18 months to 2 years, we're going to have to do this.
What about Dom and Margarita? What will happen to your mall-based restaurant?
I think I really appreciate Eric's point of view about how we really need to be resilient to change the entire business model. But for those of us who are mall-based, I think that this is really a real kind of wake-up call, not just for all of us restaurateurs to get together as a group. I know we have HRAP, but we don't really use it as a venue for all of us to get together. Maybe this is the time for us to have just like one place where we can all communicate and really kind of discuss what the challenges are as a group. I think that really this is the time for us to work together, to hold each other's hands, to be able to create the right formula that will make it both workable and feasible for both the landlord and the tenant.
Looking at the back end naman of our operations, what COVID did was it created fissures in the supply chain. It did not eradicate the supply, the produce. I think us human beings have advanced well enough to produce enough food for everyone. It's not like World War I where they implemented wheatless Wednesdays, meatless Mondays. That's not gonna happen. We have enough vegetables, we have enough meats, but the virus which affected the people who actually moved the produce were locked down. So it's really the supply chain that's disrupted right now. So we are hoping as we go along, the government gives us more leeway when it comes to food, so we can deliver the raw materials that our restaurants need to deliver to our customers.
To Belle, in your Facebook account, you raised valid questions, stuff that every restaurateur should be thinking about when running the restaurant. Stuff like eating in a buffet again, or bringing your kids to children's parties at their favorite burger joint, or taking Lola out to the crowded restaurant. What do we make of these now?
Yeah, well, that's interesting, you know, because just the other day I was talking to a futurist, and then he's saying, okay, the number one concern of everybody now is safety, right? And so we should be looking at creating a customer safety centric environment. I don't think that we should be waiting. I think we come together, we set the standards, talk to our customers, what will make them feel safe again. we go through the sequence of service. For example, very basic, because I teach this stuff. When we reopen, Gaita, 50% capacity, are you going to cut your seats in half? In half, okay. Does the waiter lead you to the table? No more. Don't touch me, right? Am I going to lap your napkin? No more. Is it going to be a paper napkin or is it going to be a cloth napkin? Is it going to be a disposable menu or is it going to be a laptop? Are we going to do cash paying or is it going to be all phone? Or is it going to be a QR code? Waiters' uniforms, very interesting. What will it look like? Will he wear this really sexy looking face shield? Gloves? Gloves can get dirty too. How often will I change the gloves? Or should I just wash my hands? There should just be sinks beside the pickup and you see me wash my hand before I touch your plate. What will be our utensils? Is it going to be go back to that old-fashioned where it comes out of hot water and then I will polish it in front? And it's an interesting question. I don't think we're going to go from closed to open. We're going to go to opening slowly. So now, what can restaurants and hotels do now? I think communicate. Because I see also a lot of people who are not communicating. Gaita, you say you're training your people. They need to see that. Eric, they see that you're cleaning. You're doing all these innovations. They need to see that. Because what people are doing now is they're dreaming of when they will leave the house.
I think what we need to do, Dom, Eric, myself, all of us that are in the restaurant business, is really to call on the relationships that we've built with our clientele through the years. We have to make them feel reassured and secure that we're doing the most that we can to make this a safe exercise for them to come and visit us again. And the market is wide, the competition is steep, so we need to call in those relationships. Build on them, reassure them, let them know that we are a step ahead. Because when the doors open, we can't be kind of, you know, still guessing what we're going to do. We need to think about that now so yes. That when the doors do open, we'll be ready and we'll be a step ahead.
I asked people to send their questions prior to this talk, and here are some of them. I think the first is for you, Dom. In this one-of-a-kind global crisis in which force majeure received an unprecedented red carpet welcome, should the franchising industry encourage the franchisers to support the franchisees? Actually, and you guys can back me up if you agree with me, I think the role of the chefs and the restaurateurs will be pivotal when this is over, because they will be the ones to set the new normal when it comes to dining out.
Absolutely.
It's like, okay, this is the market, this is the landscape, now you guys need to run with it. The chefs are gonna set new standards when it comes to the kind of food, the level of sanitation, right?
Agree.
I don't agree.
So I don't think this is the death of the restaurant.
Oh, definitely.
Heard it, I don't believe it. I think the restaurant will come back. People will still dine. Delivery only gives you food. Delivery only gives you food. But I go to a restaurant for the dining experience, for the commensality, right?
So, emotional connection.
Yeah.
I cook fine dining at home and I eat it and it's not the same. Same.
Something I've been hearing a lot of, the cloud kitchen. What do you think of this setup?
The concept is basically having multiple kitchens shared by multiple restaurants in a delivery optimized environment, making it more convenient that the orders don't necessarily have to come from a mall where they have to go four floors and whatnot. The key of that is that you have to be in central locations. But now we're seeing that the malls are now transitioning into a cloud mall. So that's why everyone's like, oh, let's turn it into cloud kitchens, let's turn it into hubs. But if the mall is already gonna do that, that helps us. Now the next question is, what are the charges?
I asked people to send their questions prior to this talk. And here are some of them. I think the first is for you, Dom. In this one-of-a-kind global crisis in which force majeure received an unprecedented red carpet welcome, should the franchising industry encourage the franchisers to support the franchisees? That question is from Christophe.
In franchising, there's a common theme that you see from the packages that we sell. It's always support. we support you with manpower, we support you with marketing, R&D, costing. It's a proven business model, okay? So us in the franchising industry now, we are all conscious that now is not the time to grow the franchise base. Now is the time to strengthen that base, make sure that the business models are resilient enough. The answer is yes, you can still invest now, but proceed with caution.
This is for Gaita, I think, from Trisha. What can catering companies transition to, or how can they evolve to cater to the post-pandemic market?
Oh my gosh, I think for the moment, the way I see it is really just home meal replacement of the dishes that we do, because people will probably hesitate to host events and celebrate in a big way. So we really need to be ready to have our food available on order to create, to supply the food for these events at home in a more practical way without having to do the setup.
Eric, this is from Gemma. Should we consider reevaluating our current menu to cater to certain price points?
Definitely. I mean, we've been doing that ever since the beginning anyway. So now is you have to take extra precaution in doing that, because now you have packaging costs, you now have the logistics cost, you now have all the additional. In fact, it is by far cheaper to eat inside the restaurant than to be delivered for the consumer and for the restaurant.
Okay, wrapping up, just to summarize, I think we all should just use this time to reevaluate what's important to us. Dining out in the near future is not going to be the same, and so let's make good use of our time by educating ourselves, adjusting the business models, maintaining your relationships with the customers, as mentioned earlier, and creating new content to sell our products. Before we close this session, can I ask our panel to share encouraging words to leave our listeners and friends in the industry? Let's start off with Eric.
We will go back to the restaurants. We are craving for that service, that attention to detail, being with friends. It will take time. And I hope we all work together to make it safe for everyone.
Yeah, I think food is still going to be very important, because food is a very, eating good food is something that we all need, you know. And I think also the very interesting thing during that crisis is that what we have noticed is that the only money we want to spend is on food. We don't need to buy clothing, we don't need to buy makeup. We are now just buying food. So I think we notice that we have a very strong relation with food. So it's a very difficult time. But for me, food and everything around food and restaurants and cooking is something that is very important. It's vital.
There will be a new normal for sure. The restaurants will open. The only thing that's uncertain is the when. But I think we can already talk about the how and what our ideas are. And we have now the luxury of having all this time to just think and research. Other countries have best practices already. And I'm an academic. And I think, and I told Angelo this, I ask more questions than I can answer. And I think now is the time to listen. To be continuing asking these questions and listening to your customer, listening to your staff. And whatever strat plan we had before, that doesn't work anymore. We need a new strat plan.
I think we just have to really take this time to observe and adapt and become more resilient in terms of our businesses, in terms of our communications with our customers and also our investors. And again, as I said earlier, these trends will go beyond our narrow industries. So it doesn't only apply to food, doesn't only apply to hotels, tourism. It will go beyond all of our industries. So if we can get information with best practices from different industries and we make something out of it, I'm sure we can survive and become better business operators, better customers, better consumers after this pandemic.
Thank you, Gaita.
Hi. Well, just like all the other panelists, I'm really thankful, Angelo, for this wonderful opportunity. I think that this challenge has it's really swept the rug from under our feet, but at the same time, it's also allowed us to really think about what's important moving forward. Aside from that, it's also made me realize that our industry is so resilient. Before talking to all of you today, I felt a little bit alone, and I felt a little bit kind of like worried and apprehensive about how I was going to move forward. But after today, I really hope that we can continue to hold hands and see ourselves through this. In the end, our problems are the same. And this is a real shout out also to the people that work for us and that work with us. You guys are the future of our business. Your lives are as important to us as our own. So I think that moving forward, thinking of them and our teams and how we can sustain this is really the utmost, I think, for me, the goal, to be able to keep our industry moving forward. So let's keep holding on, and see you all again, Angelo, soon.
You know that saying that people are like tea bags? You never know how strong they are until you put them in hot water. And more than ever, we're recognizing a powerful sense of community among the people, not just here, but all over the world. So we should hold on to that long after the pandemic is gone. If anything, yeah. This is a reminder that we love what we're doing, and that's the reason we're doing it. So in closing, the hospitality and F&B industries will definitely be coming out of this different than ever before. But one thing that won't change is our love for the trade. We will still be cooking and providing food. We will still be offering a good experience to our customers, because that's what we're built to do. Only this time, things will come out in a different package, hopefully a better one. So thank you very much. I'd like to thank our panelists for sharing your time.
Thank you, everyone.